This is EE698i, mixed signal IC design, and this is lecture number 18. In this class, let us start to look at the different ADC architectures in detail. So let's start with the first and the simple one called the flash ADC. The idea here is simple. Well, we have our input voltage and we want to digitize it. And say we want to realize a 3-bit ADC. So we take the entire range of 0 to VDD and compare it with 7 different reference voltages, namely VDD by 8, 2 VDD by 8, so on till 7 VDD by 8. Right? So this is what we need to do. And this is done in a flash ADC by having 7 different comparators operating in parallel. Right, so all of them compare the same input voltage with different reference voltages. So let's say this is the smallest one, VREF by 8. So this, let's say, the last but one, and this last. Okay. And I'm not showing the sampling operation here because it's assumed that we'll do it inside this comparator. Okay. So here it's clear that for a 3-bit ADC, we need a total of 7 comparators. Right. So in general, for an n-bit ADC, we need 2 power n minus 1 comparators. Right. So let us say if we have a flash ADC and if we want to improve the resolution by 1 bit, the number of comparators will have to roughly double. Right. So because of this area overhead, usually the flash ADC is restricted. The resolution of a flash ADC in practice is within 5 to 6 bits. Okay. And there is one more reason why flash ADC is not preferred for high resolutions, which we'll see later in the class. So for the flash ADC, the only or the important building block here is this comparator. So let's see how we can design a comparator using circuits. So what's a comparator? It's a block that takes 2 inputs, V1 and V2, and finds whether V1 is greater than V2 or less than V2. Right? If it's V1 is greater than V2, the output will be VDD or it will be 0. Right? So if you look at the input-output characteristics, so this is the input, which is V1 minus V2 here. And if I call it Vout, V0, ideally, the input-output characteristics must look like this kind of a signum function, right? So for the input, when the input is less than 0, we have 0. And when the input is greater than 0, we have VDD, right? So let's see how we can design this. One obvious and elementary way of designing a comparator is to have an amplifier with a sufficiently large gain, right? So if we have an amplifier, let's say I just show one input for simplicity. If it's, this is the input Vin, the output is going to be amplified by a factor A. And if the amplifier operates within VDD and ground, obviously, if the gain is large enough, the output will saturate to VDD or ground, right? And what is the minimum input for which the output will be VDD here? That's simply VDD by the gain A. Okay. So for any input which is greater than VDD by A, the comparator will give the right output and it's VDD. Okay. And here, remember that this output need not exactly go to VDD. This will be fed to some other block, a digital block, most probably some kind of a flip-flop to resample this output. So this output here must be greater than the VIH of this digital block. That is the minimum input for this block, which will be recognized as a logic one. Okay. So roughly we'll take it to be VDD here. And of course, if this gain here is not enough, what we'll do, we can increase the gain by cascading, say, two amplifiers. So let's say this is A, all of them are operating in the rail, say VDD and ground, or say VDD and VSS. Okay, and let's say the input is sampled across a sampling capacitor here. So this is our input, say some delta V. The output here, this V will be amplified by a factor A squared. And if delta V is greater than VDD by A squared, then the comparator output will reach the supply rail. Okay. So in principle, if you look at this if you look at the time domain response of this comparator, let's say at this moment, the input here is connected. Okay. And we expect that instantaneously the output saturates to VDD. Right, as long as the input is greater than VDD by A square. But of course, in practice, we know that here we'll not have ideal op amps, we'll have OTAs, right, and say some GM and some output resistance here. Similarly, GM and some output resistance. So the gain here is GM times R. But on top of it, we'll also have parasitic capacitors at each node, right? So the output is not going to jump to VDD instantly, but it's going to settle slowly like this, right? And to increase the overall gain, if you keep cascading more and more stages, the output will also settle more slowly, right? So this is going to take a long time for the comparison operation. So obviously this doesn't look like a great choice. So let's see what we can do to make this comparator faster. Let us say we have the input sampled across the sampling capacitor C. And let's say the sampled voltage is some delta V. Now what we need to do here, well, if delta V is greater than zero, we need to increase the voltage here and then make it go all the way to VDD, right? Similarly, if delta V is less than zero, we need to reduce it and bring it to 0 volt or VSS. Okay. And if let us say delta V is greater than zero, how do we make it, make this voltage increase to VDD? Well, for that, we need to push in some current to the capacitor, right? Similarly, if we want to reduce the capacitor voltage, what we need to do? In that case, we need to take out current from the capacitor. Okay. So which means what we need is the following. We need to have a block that generates a current dependent on delta V. If delta V is positive, it needs to push out a current. And if delta V is negative, it has to sink in some current. Right. And this can be done using an OTA, or a voltage controlled current source. Okay. So now if delta V is positive, the current pushed out here will be GM delta V. And obviously we want the current to be pushed into the capacitor. So we can simply connect it like this. Okay. So now what will happen? The current GM delta V flows into the capacitor. So the capacitor voltage will increase, which means the current here will further increase, which will in turn increase the voltage until we hit the supply rail. Okay. So what we have here is some kind of a positive feedback. Okay. And how do you think the output voltage, that is this voltage here, if I call V, how do you think V of T, will vary with time? Well, initially V of T is delta V, and then we have the current GM delta V getting pushed in, which will increase its voltage. This in turn increases the current further, So which means the voltage here will increase further, right? So this looks like some kind of an exponential increase, right? And that's what actually happens. We can solve it and confirm it ourselves. So if the voltage here, if I call it to be V of t, what is this current? It's going to be Gm times V of t, right? So what we have here is Gm times V of t. That same current goes here, that is equal to the capacitor current, which is C times dV by dt. So we can simply write it like this, dV by V equal to dt into Gm by C. So we can easily solve this and find that V is delta V times e power Gm by C into t, right? Where we assume that the initial condition, that is V of zero, is delta. Okay. So the output voltage, if let us say this is t equal to zero, the output voltage will start to increase exponentially and then reach the supply rate. Okay. Similarly, if it is less than zero, it will start to reduce and reach the ground. Okay. And let us say we have a total time period of Ts by 2 allotted for the comparator, then the output voltage at the end of the comparison phase will be what? Will be G delta V into e power Gm by C times Ts by 2, right? So which means the gain here is what? This is final V out. So let me call some V out here. So what is the gain here? It is simply e power Gm by C into Ts by 2, right? So obviously this will be much, much greater than what you can achieve using simple amplifiers here. Okay. So we saw how we can have a faster comparison for a single-ended case. So let's now do the same thing for a fully differential case. So here we'll have two sampling capacitors, one sampling the positive half, and the input is say VCM plus some delta V in by 2. Here let us say it is VCM minus delta V in by 2. So what we need here will be a fully differential voltage control current source. So let's say it is this. So this is positive, negative, positive, negative. So the positive side will get connected here. Similarly, negative side will get connected here. Okay. And what is the simplest voltage control current source we know of? Well, we can either use a differential NMOS transconductor or a PMOS transconductor, or we can use a CMOS transconductor also, right? In a CMOS transconductor, we will have both the PMOS and the NMOS operating in parallel, right? So let me draw it like this. So this will be for one half, and the other differential half will be exactly similar. Okay. And here, if I call this as the positive input, this will be the negative output. So if this is the negative input, this is the positive output. So remember that we need to have a positive feedback where the positive output is getting connected to the positive input. So the connection will look something like this. So this is the positive input. So we'll connect it. I'll connect the positive input to the positive output. Similarly, negative output will get connected to the negative input, right? And of course, here we'll have the sampling capacitors. Okay. And obviously, we can clearly see that this is a CMOS inverter. So if this is the CMOS inverter here with Vi and Vo, we know that it's input output characteristics will look something like this. So where should it be biased so that it operates as a good transconductor? Well, here you can see that if delta V in is zero, we do not want any current to be pushed out of the transconductor, right? So which means that the current coming out here must be zero if the differential input is zero. So which means the current through the NMOS and the PMOS must be equal. And for a CMOS inverter, when will that be the case? Well, when we choose both input to be equal to the output voltage, and that will correspond to the midpoint voltage Vm for the CMOS inverter, right? So at this voltage, both the input and the output voltages are equal, and the currents through the PMOS and NMOS will also be same. Okay, so what we need to ensure is that we need to have the common mode voltage VCM to be equal to the midpoint voltage. So if you bias the CMOS inverter like that, it's going to operate as a good transconductor, right? So now that we know this is essentially a CMOS inverter, let's redraw the circuit using its symbol. So this is our CMOS inverter. So let us say this is the first inverter. Okay, so its output is connected to the input of the second CMOS inverter. So let me draw it like this. Okay. And the output of the second CMOS inverter is connected back to the first. And then we have the capacitors here, right? So what we have here is two inverters put back to back together, forming a latch, right? So this is essentially a latch. And this is what we'll be using for our comparator, right? So this is also called regenerative latch, okay? Because the output kind of regenerates quickly from a very small delta V and rises exponentially and reaches the supply voltage VDD. Okay. So let me draw the regenerative latch separately here. So this is our cross-coupled CMOS inverter. Right. So here we'll have the sampling capacitors. Right. So obviously, how will the overall circuit look like? Well, we'll have the sampling operation happening in one phase. So let's say it's the phase phi 1, wherein we'll sample it, right? And then during the other phase, we'll give it to the inverter. Okay. So we can have something like this, phi 1, phi 2, and then give it to our regenerative latch like this. But in practice, instead of using a separate capacitor here, what we'll do is the following. We will actually exploit the gate parasitic capacitors at these nodes. Okay. So instead of having a separate sampling capacitor, we'll directly sample the inputs onto these parasitic capacitors at the gate. Okay. This is because, especially in flash ADCs, as I mentioned, the maximum resolution we design is around 6 bits, right? And for a 6-bit ADC, the maximum signal-to-noise ratio is around 37 dB, right? So which means if you take a 1 volt sinusoidal input, the sinusoidal input power is minus 3 dB, so which means the noise power is minus 40 dB, right? And remember, the impact as the sampling capacitance value has is the thermal noise, right? It adds to the KT by C noise. So we need to choose the sampling capacitor such that the KT by C noise is less than the required noise power, right? So in this case, it's minus 40 dB. So it corresponds to 10 power minus 4 volt square. So if you equate it to KT by C, you can find the capacitance value at room temperature to be around 40 attofarad, And this is obviously extremely small, right? And the gate parasitic capacitance will easily be of this order or sometimes be even higher. Okay, so there is no need for using an additional sampling capacitor in this flash ADC, right? And also, please notice that we are not using any kind of bottom plate sampling or any other additional technique for improving the linearity, because we are only targeting an SNR of 37 dB. And for this case, we don't need to have any additional bottom plate sampling or gate bootstrapping switches and so on. Okay. So let me draw the complete circuit. So this is the first CMOS inverter. This is the second CMOS inverter. So they're connected back to back. And then we have the sampling switch here. Right, so this sampling switch here samples the input onto this gate capacitance. And this switch here samples the input onto this capacitance. So let's say this is 5151. This is VCM plus delta V in by 2. This is VCM minus delta V in by 2. Okay. So let's say this is ground and this is VD. Let me also show the gate capacitor separately. Okay. So now when the switch 51 or these switches controlled by 51 are closed, that is when we are sampling the input, do you think the inverter here needs to be operational? Again, please pause the video and think. Well, if the inverter is also operational, then we have two things that are trying to set this voltage, right? One, we are trying to sample the input voltage. And at the same time, the inverter is also trying to push this node either to ground or pull it up to VDD. Okay. So obviously we do not want the inverter to be doing the comparison when we are actually sampling the input, right? So what we do is the following. Oops. We don't have the inverter operational during the sampling phase. Okay. So we'll make sure that the inverter is shut off when we are sampling the input, and we enable it only during the phase phi 2, which we allot for doing the comparison. Okay. And the simplest way to shut off the inverter is to disconnect them from the supply and ground. And these switches will be controlled by phi 2. So only during the phase phi 2, the inverter will be operational. Right? And this circuit here, remember that it compares only if delta V in is greater than 0 or less than 0. Right? But in a flash ADC, we saw that we also need to compare the input with several reference voltages. So let's see how we can subtract this reference voltage here. And please remember that since we are having a fully differential circuit, even the reference voltage must be fed in a fully differential manner. Okay. And here the differential input is delta V in, and this indeed can take values from minus VDD to plus VDD. Right. So we need to have, say, so many reference voltages. I'll call them, say, VREF1. VREF2 and so on, right? So this is the differential reference voltage. So individually, we need to supply them as some VREFP, say kth reference voltage as VCM plus VREFK by 2. Similarly, VREFM for the kth reference voltage is VCM minus VREFK by 2. Okay. And how can we generate them? Well, remember that if we have VDD and minus VDD in principle, since these are all equally spaced reference voltages, we can generate them using a resistive ladder like this. Right? So if this top resistor is connected to plus VDD and the bottom is connected to minus VDD, so this will directly give us VREF1, VREF2, and so on. Okay. but obviously we don't have both positive and negative supplies, right? So what we'll do is the following. We notice that we actually need Vref K/2/1 minus Vref K/2. So essentially we can do that by simply scaling these voltages. So this will be Vref 1/2. Let's say this is some Vref, I don't know, some K/2, right? And Vref P of K is simply VCM plus Vref K/2, right? So we need to add VCM, which is equal to VDD/2, right? To all these voltages. So I'll shift all the voltages up by VDD/2. Right, so which means this is now going to become VDD. So I'll have VDD and the bottom is going to become ground. Okay, so this is going to give me Vref 1/2 plus VCM. This will be Vref K/2 plus VCM. Okay, and similarly, we can also generate the minus reference voltage, that is VRFCM, following something similar. So here, notice that we need minus Vref K/2. So let's say this was the earlier resistive ladder we had, when we had plus VDD/2 and minus VDD/2. Remember that this gave us Vref 1/2, right? And let's say this was some Vref K/2. So now we need to flip the voltage. So I'll just flip it. So which means this will be minus Vref 1/2. This will be minus Vref K/2, right? But if you want VRFM, we need to add VCM to this. So I'll add VCM to all these voltages. So this is getting added everywhere. Okay. So this is going to become ground, right? And this is going to become equal to VDD, right? So let me push it aside. So which means this is going to give me plus VCM, and this will add VCM here. Okay. And so which means if we have two resistive ladders like this, I can generate both this VRFP and VRFM. Okay. So now let's see how to subtract these reference voltages before doing the comparison. Again, in principle, if we had a voltage source with a value some VRF, okay, if this is Vin, this is going to be Vin minus VRF, right? But of course, we do not have a voltage source on an integrated circuit. So we use the next best thing we have, which is a capacitor that is sampled, that is charged to the required VRF voltage. Okay, so what we'll do is the following. During the phase phi 1, instead of directly sampling the input onto the gate capacitor, we'll connect it to a capacitor first that is charged to the required voltage, the required reference voltage, okay, and then connect it to the CMOS inverter. So let me draw the inverter again. So this is connected here. Similarly, on the other side, we have something similar, right? And during the phase phi 2, we will have the cross-coupled inverters starting to operate, which and during that phase, we are not doing the sampling operation. These switches are off. So which means in that time, we can charge the capacitor to the required reference voltage. Okay, so this will be VCM plus some delta V in. This will be our VRFP of some kth reference voltage. Okay. And this capacitor, let's say it's some CB. Right. And how should we choose CB? Well, remember that during the sampling phase, we have the equivalent circuit like this. So we have CB here that was charged to the required reference voltage. Okay. And then we have the gate capacitance here. Right. Let's say it's some CG. We need to make sure that this CB is much larger than the gate capacitance so that it holds the voltage holds the voltage to which it was previously charged, right? And this happens during the phase fight. Okay. So now let us say we have the circuit to be like this. What will happen is this. So let us say in one cycle, these voltages, say Vx and Vy, are as follows. Say, let's say Vx was at VDD and Vy is at zero. Okay. So now in the next sampling phase, what will happen? We'll have the equivalent circuit like this. So again, this is the equivalent circuit, right? I'll also show the on resistance of the switches, right? So we'll have one on resistance here and one more switch resistance here. And this is VCM plus delta V, right? And remember that this node is Vx and this capacitor here would have been charged to VDD at the end of the previous comparison phase. So this was initially charged to VDD, right? So if you look at the voltage Vx during the sampling phase, two things will happen simultaneously. One, this initial voltage VDD will start to decay, right? And second, the capacitor will get charged to the input voltage. Of course, the input voltage minus this reference voltage, okay? And since this initial voltage of VDD will not be completely decayed to zero, we'll have some residue, let's say some VRes. For VY, remember VY was initially pulled to zero, right? At the end of the previous comparison phase. So there is no initial voltage for VY. So VY will get charged to the required input voltage, which I'll call VIM. Okay. So now if we didn't have VRes, and let us say VIP was some minus 1 millivolt and VIM was plus 1 millivolt, what will happen? Well, this voltage is smaller and this voltage is larger, right? So which means this voltage is minus 1 millivolt, let us say, and this is plus 1 millivolt, right? So which means current will be pulled out of this capacitor and this will eventually reach to zero and this will reach VDD. This is the right operation, right? But now if let us say VRes was some 4 millivolt or something, so which means this will now become 3 millivolt, right? Whereas the other voltage Vy will still be 1 millivolt, right? So which means now Vx is greater than Vy, right? This is 1 millivolt. So which means now this will get pulled to VDD and this will get pulled to zero. Okay. So because of this initial conditions being different for both Vx and Vy during the sampling phase, what will happen depending on the previous comparison result and the present input, we might get wrong result, right? So this is called comparator hysteresis, wherein the output of the comparator is no longer dependent only on the inputs that it is seeing currently, but also on the previous comparison output. So to prevent this hysteresis, what we need to do? Well, we need to ensure that both Vx and Vy start with the same initial condition, right? So for that, what we do is, okay, let me draw it clearly once again. So this is the circuit we have already. This is the sampling phase. This is when we have VCM, this delta V in. This is some VRefP. This is VCM. Similarly, we have it here. Okay, this is 515152. And then we have the CMOS inverters. Okay. This is VRFM and VCM. Okay, and let's say these are the gate capacitors. So this is VX and this is VY, right? And we also have switches here. Now the problem here happened because both VX and VY started with different initial conditions, right? So what we make sure is that after the comparison is over, we preset both VX and VY to the same voltage. Okay, so we can use one more switch to either pull these two nodes to VDD ground, or we can simply short them also, right? So let me just show, like, we are having a switch here that's connecting the outputs to VDD. And VDD is here, right? And when should this switch be active? Well, if it's active during the phase phi 1, then we'll have a problem, right? Because we are trying to sample the input here. At the same time, we are trying to pull it to VDD. Now, if you try to make the switch on during phi 2, then obviously that's not going to work because we'll not have any effect of the comparison. So which means we need to have an additional phase, right? So if I call this as phi 1, and let's say this is another non-overlapping phase phi 2. Okay. We need to have one more phase phi 3 after the comparison is over, wherein we reset both the outputs to some predetermined voltage, right? So that during the next sampling phase, both start with the same initial condition and we do not end up with this kind of a situation, right? Now, if we had reset both of them to VDD, what will happen? Even for VY, we'll have a same residual voltage, right? So this will also be some 4 millivolt. So which means this is plus 3 millivolt and this is plus 5 millivolt, right? And we'll have the right comparison result. Okay. So this is one kind of latch that we can use for the comparator. Okay. And obviously there are multiple variants of this latch, but at the heart of each comparator, we'll have this cross-coupled inverter, right? Because this is the magic block that does regeneration and helps us resolve the differential input and do a faster comparison. So let's now look at one more variant, which is popularly used. So the circuit looks like this. So we have a differential pair, an NMOS differential pair. Okay. And it is connected to, no surprise, back-to-back connected CMOS inverter. And we'll have two more switches here. Let reset these output voltages and the intermediate modes to VDD. Okay. So all of them are clocked with the same clock, phi 2. This is at phi 2. And this is where we give our differential input. Okay. So here when phi 2 is slow, this switch is off. So which means the back-to-back connected inverter will not be operational. Same as this differential pair also. And we'll have all these nodes getting reset to VDD, right? And once phi 2 is made high, these switches are off, right? And this is now on. So which means the circuit will start to amplify and try to do the comparison. So let's see how the waveforms will look like. So let's say if I call these voltages P, Q, and the outputs as X and Y, same as before. So how will the outputs look like? So let's say this is T. First, let's see how P and Q look like. Remember that when phi 2 was low, both these nodes were reset to VDD, right? So just at the start of the phase phi 2, this node will be at VDD, so which means this transistor will be off. Same with these two nodes, so this will also be off. So we'll have the equivalent circuit like this. So we'll have only the differential pair active, right? And at P and Q, we have two capacitors, which are the parasitic capacitors at that node, which would have been charged to VDD, right? So they would have been charged to VDD. And let's say this is when phi 2 becomes high. Okay, from this point, phi 2 is high. So now what will happen? We have a differential input applied. So we'll have a differential currents getting pulled out of both the nodes P and Q. And remember the differential currents, if I call, let's say I1, I2, I1 will be proportional to the differential input delta V in by 2. And I2 will be proportional to minus dm delta V in by 2. Okay. So which means what will happen? Well, currents are being drawn out of these two nodes. So the voltage across the capacitor will start to reduce. And since we are having a constant, let's say we have delta V to be constant. So which means the constant current is getting pulled out of both P and Q. Hence the voltages will drop linearly, but they'll drop with different slopes, right? Because the currents are unequal. Okay. And in this case, if delta V is positive, then I1 will be larger. So which means this will be P. So P will drop faster than Q. And this will continue till when? Remember, we have also an NMOS here. Let me remove it. We have an NMOS here. Right? And it is connected, the gate of this NMOS is connected to Y, right? So the node Y. Similarly, this gate is connected to the node X. And even here, we will have two parasitic capacitors. And they were also charged to VDD, right? So these two transistors will be off. And they get turned on when both P and Q become less than VDD minus VTH, right? So let's say at this point, they reach the value of VDD minus VTH. Then what will happen? Then both these NMOS will start to conduct. So which means both the nodes X and Y, okay, which were initially at VDD, they will now start to drop, and they will again start to drop with some, they will now start to drop with some slope, and the slopes will again be dependent on the differential input. Okay, so since here P is dropping faster, X will also drop faster. So X will drop faster here. Okay. And remember that on top, we also have the NMOS above this, right? So let me draw the NMOS. Sorry, we know we also have the PMOS above the NMOS. So let me draw the PMOS also. And again, the PMOS gate of this PMOS is connected to Y. And here it's connected to X. Okay. And the PMOS will be off till the nodes, the node voltages and X and Y, that is VX and VY, and when the node voltages X and Y becomes less than VDD minus VOD VTHP, then the PMOS will also start to conduct. And let us say both X and Y, they reach the voltage somewhere at this point. Okay. So at this point, the PMOS is also on, right? So which means now the entire CMOS inverter is on. So the regeneration will start to kick in. So the lower voltage will go like this to zero and the higher voltage will regenerate to VDD. Okay. So this is a rough basic operation of this latch. So this is called strong arm latch. And it got its name because this latch was used in a RISC processor, microprocessor, a long time back, and that processor's name was strong arm. And the the advantage with this latch is that in the older latch architecture, you see that we require three different clock phases, right? And you can obviously imagine that generating this extra clock phase 5-3 is not so easy. It will require additional hardware, right? But here you see that we just need one are controlled by the same clock phase, okay? So that's the advantage with the strong arm latch. Remember that here in this latch or even in the previous latch architectures, the output voltage is available only during or only at the end of the comparison phase, right? So we need to make sure that we resample and store this comparator output. Okay, so let's say this is the comparator we have, right? So let's say some input and output. Okay, this is, let's say, the strong arm latch, right? So what we need to do is we need to make sure that this output is resampled and stored onto some other flip-flop. Okay. And when can we clock the flip-flop? Well, if this is phi 2, remember that phi 2 is a phase when the comparator is active. So the output will be available somewhere before the end of phi 2. So we can use the falling edge of phi 2 to latch or to resample this comparator output. Okay. Let us now see what non-idealities we can expect from these latches. Non-idealities. And if you look at all these latches, we see that we have a fully differential structure, right? We have some kind of a differential pair like this, where if there is no differential input, the gate voltages are same and the source voltage is shared, right? Even in the other latch structure, we see that if there is no input, the gate voltages will be same and it shares the same source voltage. Okay, so let's consider this differential pair here. Right, so the gate voltages are same, the source voltage is same. And for an NMOS transistor, all that matters is the gate overdrive, right? Which is VGS minus VTH. And ideally, we expect that both the transistors are identical. Okay. So if you look at the gate overdrive for the first transistor, that is going to be VG minus VS minus VTH. For the second transistor, it is also the same. So no issues. But in practice, on an integrated circuit, we'll have some mismatch between the transistors. So if, let us say, the second transistor had a threshold of VTH, this could have some VTH plus delta VTH, right? So which means the gate power drive will now be this minus delta VTH, right? And obviously this can be thought of as having a gate voltage of VG minus delta VTH, okay? Well, assuming that the threshold voltage is same. So this is similar to having two identical transistors with the same threshold voltage. Whereas for this transistor, we have a delta VTH applied at the input. Okay. So what does this mean? Well, we have some kind of an offset, right? So nominally, if we have we had some VI1 and VI2, right? The latch would have compared VI1 minus VI2, but now it is going to compare VI minus delta VTH minus VI2. Okay. So instead of having input output characteristics like this, we'll now have a shifted version, either to the left or to the right. Okay, so this is going to result in some static offset. Not just due to the mismatch in the threshold voltages, any kind of mismatch between the properties of these two transistors or between the properties of any two transistors here, which were supposed to be identical, all of these will result in an offset. Okay. And in a latch, we can have offset due to the mismatch from some other portion also. And to understand that, let's look at this waveform in some more detail. Let me quickly copy paste this. So for simplicity and for easier understanding, let's consider this strong arm latch here. So let's say these are the voltages V1 and V2, and we had assumed that V1 is greater than V2, which means the current in this direction, I1, will be greater than I2, right? So which means Vx will drop down faster compared to Vy, and so eventually Vx will get pulled to zero, while Vy will get regenerated to VDD. Okay. And now let's look at the transient waveforms in some detail again. So this is the time at which the latch is made active, right? So this switch here is turned on. Okay. And please recollect that in the beginning, this CMOS inverter is not active, and only this NMOS differential pair is active, right? So we'll have these two currents, I1 and I2, getting drawn out of these two nodes P and Q, right? So let me show P with some other color. So initially, both P and Q would have been reset to VDD, right? And now we have a constant current I1 getting drawn out of P, and I2 getting drawn out of Q. And since I1 is larger than IQ, VP will ramp down at a rate faster than that of Q. Right? So we'll have VP ramping down at a faster slope compared to VQ. Right? So this is VP and this is VQ. Right? And this will continue till VP and Q fall to VDD minus VTH of this NMOS device, right? Once this happens, these two transistors turn on, okay? So which means they will start to conduct current like this. So which means we'll have currents getting pulled out of these two nodes, Vx and Vy, right? So let's say this is the point at which the NMOS transistor turns on. So let's now see how these two mode voltages, which are the final outputs, look like. So again, both Vx and Vy, they'll be reset to VDD initially, and they will stay there till this point. Let me show Vx in some other color. Okay. And now once these two NMOS transistors turn on, we'll have some current drawn out of these two nodes, right? And so Vx and Vy, they will fall down. Right, and since the current in this branch is larger, Vx will fall down at a rate faster than Vy. So we'll have Vx coming down faster compared to Vy, right? And this will continue till these two voltages, they fall to less than VDD minus mod VTH of the PMOS device. And once this happens, this PMOS transistor turns on. Okay. So now the entire CMOS inverter is active. So it will start to regenerate, right? So what it will do, it will look at these two node voltages, whichever is higher, that will get regenerated to VDD, and whichever is lower, that will go to zero, right? So let's say at this point, the CMOS inverter starts to become active. Okay. And here it is clear that this is Vx. Right, and this is Vy. Vy is much larger than Vx, So which means Vy will get regenerated to VDD and Vx will go to ground, right? So this is the nominal operation, correct? And here, please notice that the rate at which the two node voltages Vx and Vy fall down depends on the currents in these two branches, which in turn depend on the differential input, right? If the differential input is larger, this current will be larger. But also this slope depends on the capacitors at these two nodes. Okay, so let me call them C naught X and C naught Y. Okay. So now let us say we have the differential input to be very small. So in that case, what will happen? And first we'll assume that both C naught X and C naught Y are equal. So in that case, what will happen? Well, since the differential input is small, the change in the slope, that is the change in the rate at which Vx and Vy fall down, will not be so much. So if let us say Vx falls down like this, Vy will fall down at a slower rate, but it won't be that different. Okay, so it will be like this, right? And let's say later at some point here, oops, let me stick to the colors. So let's say later at some point here, this point, the CMOS inverter starts to kick in, then we'll have regeneration happening. So Vy will go to VDD and Vx will go to zero. Okay, still no problem. So now let us say the differential input is still small, but we have a mismatch in these capacitors. That is, C0X is not equal to C0Y. And for example, let's assume that the capacitor at the node Y is smaller than the capacitance at the node X. Okay. So which means the rate at which the node voltage Y drops down can now be actually greater than the rate at which X drops, right? Because remember the slope or the rate at which the voltages ramp down, that depend on the ratio of the current and the capacitance. Now we saw that the differential input is small, so the differential current is small. Okay, so which means if there is a mismatch in the capacitance value, it can so happen that the rate at which Vy is ramping down can be faster compared to the rate at which Vx was ramping. Okay. And again, once, say at this point, the CMOS inverter now starts to kick in. Okay. So now the CMOS inverter will look at these two voltages and it will find that Vx is larger. So it will mistakenly regenerate it to VDD and Vy will go to zero. Right, so this is Vx and this is Vy. Okay, so this is obviously a wrong decision, right? And this is happening because we have a mismatch in the capacitance at these output nodes. Okay, and please remember that this mismatch will be a problem only for small input voltages, right? The moment we have a large differential input, the differential current will also be larger. So the difference in these two currents will be larger. So in one case, we'll have say Ix by C and Iy by C naught X and C naught Y, right? These are the slopes roughly. So if we make sure that the differential input is larger, then Ix will be much larger than Iy. So even if C naught X is greater than C naught Y, the slope here will be greater than Iy by C naught Y, right? And if this is satisfied, we'll have no issues. Okay. So the bottom line is that for small differential inputs, we'll still not get the correct output, right? So this will again result in some kind of an offset, because ideally, the moment the differential input crossed 0 volt, we wanted the output to be VDD. That is, we wanted Vy to be VDD. But here we clearly found that even for small positive differential input, the output is still zero, right? Only if it crosses some voltage here, it will go to VDD, right? So this will again result in offset. And this offset is called the dynamic offset. Okay. And although we considered this only for the strong arm latch, even for the other latch architecture that we saw, we'll have this dynamic offset. Okay, even here, if we have mismatch in the capacitors, and also if we had a condition where the common mode of the input doesn't match the midpoint of the inverter. Okay, so in that case, we'll have a dynamic offset. Okay, please remember that in this case, we assume that the common mode of the input was equal to the midpoint voltage of the inverter. Okay, if this condition is not satisfied, then any kind of mismatch in the output capacitors will again introduce dynamic offset in this latch. Okay. Now, why is this offset a problem? Well, recollect that ideally we wanted a quantizer characteristic like this, right? So we wanted a staircase characteristics, and these transition points correspond to the reference voltages against which the comparator makes the comparison. Okay. Now, in a flash ADC, we have multiple comparators operating in parallel. Okay. And if all the comparators are the same offset, then we don't have any issues, right? So all of these voltages will get slightly shifted to the left or right by the same amount. So we'll only have a global offset. And as we saw in our previous classes, this is not a problem. But the real problem comes because in practice, each of these comparators will have its own offset. Okay, so the offset voltage for each comparator will be different. So instead of having an ideal staircase characteristic like this, now the transition points for the first comparator might be here. For the second comparator, it might be somewhere here. We'll get something like this. For the third comparator, maybe it's fine. For the fourth comparator, it's here, and so on. Okay. So this will in turn result in nonlinearity, right? So this will add DNL and INL and will introduce nonlinearity. Okay. So obviously we cannot have a large offset for these comparators, else it will finally impact our signal to noise ratio. So in the next class, we will see how to tackle this offset and see ways to suppress it. Okay, so let's stop at this point and continue from the next class.